So hello, my name is Jordan. I've been a GNOME contributor for about 2 years now, mostly working on QA stuff and shucks nowadays. I'm a build sheriff, which means I keep stuff building. I'm involved in most of the Rust-related GNOME projects in GNOME. I enjoy writing Rust and I wait to share. I work for Centricular, which is paying for me to be here, so yeah. I also get to write Rust at work. So, GNOME is an old project. It's older than me. It was started by Miguel de Casa and Federico Mena. Good era. It's a default in the desktop environment of most Linux distribution nowadays. It has a big community of many active participants. It's built on top of glib and C. So glib is a cross-platform C library. It provides common data structures for C, because C does not have a standard library. It includes an object orientation framework called GObject. It's what Gstreamer and GTK are built on top. It's commonly used in many embedded devices, and probably you already have a couple of devices in your home that run with it. GTK is a cross-platform graphical user interface toolkit. It's used by GNOME, Elementary, GIMP, many popular applications. It's written in C with GObject. It's heavily object-oriented, uses subclasses and interfaces. It has hierarchy-based widgets, and it uses callbacks for signal handling. It also has a CSS styling engine. It provides a couple of platform integration APIs. It's built on top of Glib JIO, which is like the library for handling input and output in glib. ATK, which is an accessibility library, Caro, and Pango. It has bindings for many, many languages. There's a framework to automatically generate bindings for glib-based projects using just an XML file, and so, yeah. So Gstreamer is a cross-platform multimedia framework. It's pipeline-based, which is heavily multi-threaded. It's written in C with GObject, but it's not tied at any way to GTK. It has good Windows and macOS support, where GTK is like more of Linux toolkit nowadays. YourDB also probably is using Gstreamer for media decoding and coding. It also has bindings for many, many, many languages. Gstreamer is not an alternative to FFmpeg. You can make use of it. It's not a media player or playback library. It's not a coder protocol library. It's not a coding tool, and it's not a streaming server. But it can be used to build all of those. So, Librsvg is the first major library that got Rust code involved. It's used by GNOME, GTK, GIMP, and Wikimedia. It was originally written as part of GIL by Ralph Ergin. GIL is an acronym for GNOME Illustrator program, which later evolved into SODIPOD, and now it's Inkscape. It's about 20 years old, so there's a lot of old C code there. It was unmaintained for a while. It had a couple of CVE issues. A couple of years ago, Federico Guintera took over mentorship of Librsvg. After a while, getting fed up with the CVEs, he decided to gradually port the library to Rust. It's not a rewrite, it's a gradual port. It aims for C and API compatibility. And it has achieved that to this day still. So in 2017, in December, the last say-only version of Librsvg was released. In a couple months, there will be the next version 2.4.6, which includes all the functionality that the library uses to render an SVG. It's implemented in Rust and only Rust. The only thing that's left is the say headers and say API. It has an active community nowadays on Reddit, and it's actively developed again. Federico, Paolo, and Ivan made it possible to port a huge chunk of it to Rust. And it's now one less library. So, Librsvg still has a C API and C header files. To this end, GNOME class was started to be developed. It's meant to, in order to interface with the glib and gobject libraries, you need a CFFI, which means you need a safe code. Also, subclassing GDK and GDK stuff in general is known to have a lot of boilerplate. GNOME class is meant to be to allow you to both write syntax like if it was a higher level language like Python, but also automatically generate the unsafe code that you would need in order to interface with GObject directly. It's like Vala, which was a transpiled language that compiled into C, but it instead targets the Rust AST. So you get to write safe code without boilerplate and get all the GObject functionality. There are a couple of applications that have popped up. The first one is Fractal. Fractal is a matrix.org client. It's a big application and it was an experiment for the most part. It was written before many of the nice things were stabilized, like set the derive and serialize. So the code base is not as pretty nor easy to work with yet. There's a huge effort on refactoring it. It has a quite active community, which is like, it's amazing because like all these new people that come up that have popped out are like came up from a Rust community before. They had nothing to do with GNOME. It's nice. It was started by Daniel Garcia as a side project mostly to learn Rust. GNOME Podcast is a podcast client. It was my excuse to learn Rust. I started a year ago or so. It's about as old as Fractal. It was a nice way to learn Rust and mess with the GDK a bit. The problem is like due to some bindings limitation, like not being able to subclass yet a widget, you had like try a lot of different approaches in order to get something that's nice and maintainable to work. So the code base was rewritten a couple of times in order to make it easier to be maintainable. It has a multi-threaded and concurrent parsing indexer of RSS, which is like a year ago I had no idea what any of these words would mean. And now it's not only implemented in a few, it was not only implemented in a few weeks, it's also memory safe. It's just crazy. So, these are two old apps, but they are getting rewritten in Rust. They're not going to be gradually ported because it's not as easy. Unlike with Librsvg, it's not as easy to gradually port applications because you can't. Due to a couple of issues with both subclassing and the packaging system, you can't just write widgets in Rust and have them called while you port your app. So these both of those apps are getting rewritten from scratch. They're both third-party apps developed independent of GNOME, which is nice to see that Rust is getting adopted not only by GNOME, but also the wider community that just targets GNOME as the platform they want to run on. So GNOME has an IDE. It's called Builder. It aims to make developing GNOME applications as painless as possible. You need like 3 clicks from cloning a repository to have the application running and be able to modify it and actually have the application, the modified instance running. It does not have any host dependencies. It makes heavy use of the Flatpak and Flatpak runtimes to achieve that. Flatpak has Rust support. There's a Rust toolchain for Flatpak runtimes. Builder also has RLS support since March. It was like one of the earliest adopters. I briefly talked about Flatpak before. Flatpak is a packaging system. It's a package system Flatpak provides it's a package system for sandboxed app applications that are independent of the host and can run across any distribution and any desktop environment. It uses OS3 underneath, and OS3 is like Git for binaries. It has deduplication and can make diffs out of binaries. Repo Manager is the tool that is used for FlatHub, which is the largest Flatpak repository. It's written in Rust. It's a web server written in Rust that provides functionality similar to Git push. It will soon be deployed and power all of the Flatpak infrastructure, which is many millions of users. There's a slide missing. Oh, found it. So Cargo is wonderful, but it's not a build system, sadly. Not at least the one in the traditional sense. You usually need to distribute more than just a binary or just a .so file. So you can't just use Cargo for general distribution package management. Neither Autotools nor Meson have an easy way to support Cargo, which results in really ugly hacks with weird shell scripts and going way out of what the build system would allow. Like you can do out of three builds with due to some packaging issues. The main problem with the build system is that you have a mesh on Autotools, which wants to take control of all of the artifacts that are generating every invocation of the compiler that is run. But then at some point you have to call Cargo, because Cargo is like the only way to compile Rust code currently, and they really don't like not being able to determine what the build artifacts will be and how they will be named, where they are placed. So most of the time you end up with ugly shell scripts that have Mason call Cargo and shell to get a binary. Then have my Mason handle all the rest of the stuff, which might be installing documentation, app data, desktop files, and other stuff like that. Rust stays generally at the edit in most distributions. If you are using a long-term support release of a distribution, the Rust compiler there usually gets updated only when Firefox requires a newer one. So most of the time it's like almost a year and maybe more older. The jQuery bindings and gobject have no subclassing support in general yet, which Sebastian will be talking about later. This results in an idiomatic code, and which has a higher maintenance cost than usual idiomatic code, and it will need to be rewritten at some point currently to once subclassing available, so it will be a bit better. This is also the reason that Rust is not yet recommended, or we have any kind of templates for writing GTK applications, because the code that you will need to write today will have many workarounds, limitations of subclassing of the bindings, which at some point you will have to throw away in a couple of months. So there's also the community aspect of Rust. Rust has the most welcoming and empowering community I have ever come across. Everybody wants you to succeed. Everybody is there to help you. Everybody's super friendly. Rust also has a Rust beginners channel, which is probably misspelled there. GNOME also has a newcomers experience. There was also a GNOME newcomers workshop an hour ago. But it's not as nice as the Rust one. You just drop on the Rust channel and everybody answers you your questions 5 minutes and helps you even more. GNOME sadly doesn't have the manpower to do it. We try as much as we can, but it could get a lot better, and it's something to look forward into. The Rust code of conduct was a big thing. It's what inspired Federico to start an initiative to rewrite the GNOME code of conduct and get people to start taking it seriously again. Code of conduct is rather ambiguous and nobody really cares about it. But that's not the way we want to move forward. There's a duplication of the slide, but it's fine. There have been four hackfests so far related to Rust and GNOME. There's one every 6 months now, and people get around, discuss issues, and have a great time in general. And slides are missing. Yay. So, and that's about it. Overall, since I managed to take one slide. Any questions? Yes.
Me?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, okay. Go ahead. So the question is, how does Vala compares to Rust when it comes to the development experience in writing the code? So the process with Vala is far smoother because there's all the integration in place already. We are currently have to smooth out a couple of paper cuts and solve out the issues with the build system first, before it becomes easy. There's some ongoing work on the bindings that needs to be released first before you are able to do things like that. GNOME class is actively maintained, but it's not yet ready for prime time to get you to write G objects. A couple of things are missing, but it's getting there. Other than that, it's Okay. Yeah, it's still quite early, I think.
Yes.
Yes, yeah. So the question is when, if glib, gobject, and GDK will be rewritten in Rust. You probably want to ask, I don't think there is any chance of this happening, but you probably want to ask actual glib and GDK developers. And but it probably won't happen. It's glib is battle tested by now, and yeah. So yes, in the back.
So you mentioned that one of the problems that many distributions have outdated versions of the Rust compiler.
Yes.
A similar issue is with FreeBSD and other things. So I was wondering, since Rust also has some patches relative to LLVM, and there are some features which probably are not available
So the question was that the couple of distributions have adopted Rust C compilers, and there's that's a similar case for BSD as well. And if there was some feature that was held back due to distributions not having a current enough compiler, yes, actually there are a couple of things that would clean up the Librsvg codebase a lot, but we currently support the latest long-term releases. We support currently, I think, Rust 1.28. So we always try to not bump the version increment, the minimum version requirement, without any good reason. But sometimes you have to avoid, we can't avoid it, because create underneath us just bumps it to and needs Rust 2018 or so. Yes, in the back. So the question was, since GDK is running on Mac on Windows as well, what's the accessibility state of it, and if you can write Rust applications that are accessible to other users in those platforms? If GDK uses ATK for the accessibility integration, which stands for Unaccessibility Toolkit, I think. If GDK itself and ATK is functioning on macOS and Windows, which I don't know the state of this yet, it would work with Rust as well, with the Rust bindings as well. The bindings API-wise are fairly not fairly complete, but there's a huge range of the API that is covered already. But I'm not sure what's the status of ATK on macOS and Windows, if they integrate yet as well as on Linux.
Okay.
Thank you.